I am Mr. Chiru. Okay, we are going to do a couple of examples now of graphing a trig function, sine and cosine, that have some transformations in them, some vertical stretches, some maybe a change on the period, or horizontal and vertical, horizontal compressions or stretches, vertical shifts, and we're going to do it all without the aid of a calculator. So if your teacher is letting you graph these trig functions just with a graphing calculator, you might not like this video very much, but I teach graphing without the use of a calculator to make sure that my students understand the unit circle very, very well, can deal with adding and subtracting and multiplying fractions, and, you know, simply actually understand and comprehend this topic as opposed to just, you know, tippity-tapping on whatever kind of calculator that they bought. This is sort of like your general form of our trig functions. This can be either sine or cosine. That's all we're going to talk about today. Of course, it could be secant or cosecant or tangent. We'll be doing those other graphs in a later video. And we've got some values in here highlighted in some colors that are transformations, the same basic transformations, actually exactly the same transformations you would have learned in Chapter 1 of your pre-calculus book. And if you're not sure what these transformations are, like vertical stretches, horizontal stretch or compression values, between what trig functions B and C are going to act together to do phase shifts or left and right movements, and vertical shifts, then you may want to look up in my search one in the upper right-hand corner, transformations, and find that video that you can see how these apply and maybe some simpler questions like basic parabolas and whatnot. So when we're looking at our trig function, if A is greater than 1, our graphs are going to be stretched vertically. If it's less than 1 or between 0 and 1, it's going to be a compression. The value of A is going to be the amplitude of our trig function. I talked about that in our previous basic understanding of sine and cosine functions, and I'll also point that out once we get an example up here worked out. If your leading coefficient is negative, that's going to reflect your graph around the x-axis and sort of kind of flip it down in a sense. B and C are going to act together to set up your phase shift. That's your left to right movement. Think of like a parabola. If you graph y equals x squared, and then you graph y equals x minus 2 squared, it's going to shift that parabola to the right two places. Well, we have an addition or subtraction inside of our math function, so we'll once again have those horizontal shifts, but we call them phase shifts in trigonometry. Now, in my textbook, it shows that x can have a leading coefficient that's not 1. So the phase shift is defined in my textbook as c over b, and that's going to be the horizontal movement. If you see bx minus c, that's going to be a shift to the right, c over b units. And if you see bx plus c inside these parentheses, that will be movement to the left. Now, your textbook and my old trig book used to have this value of b in front of the parentheses, and it would hold the coefficient of x to always be 1, so that you could look inside this parentheses and see what the phase shift was. But if I factor out a b, then, of course, I'm going to have the value of c over b here anyway. And I want it to stay consistent so my students with my textbook can understand this as good as possible. If you have a plus or minus outside or at the end of your math function, it's not actually inside your math function, that's a vertical shift, just like it has always been if you learn transformations of functions. Okay, now, we are going to, again, graph these without the aid of a calculator. So we need to worry about or attempt to graph just the easy points, not the square root of 3s over 2s, not the square root of 2 over 2s and whatnot. I want to graph the easy points of 0, 1, negative 1, and that's it. So here's what I'm going to say, no matter if we're graphing sine, cosine, later on, secant, cosecant, tangent, and cotangent, I'm going to say these same two steps all the time. When you want to graph a trig function without the aid of a calculator, use your brain, you want to start a t-table at the phase shift value, and you want to count by 1/4 of the period. And as a tip, make sure to, you know, because you want to do a lot of you're going to do 5 points inside of a t-table, and to make that mental math a little bit easier, you want to write your phase shift value, your count value, and your C value, all with a common denominator, so when you work at that T table, you don't have to keep doing those common denominators in your head. It'll already be set up for you. Now, I am talking about the phase shift value, the value of C, and it's not up here, but what you're going to count by, you're going to count by 1/4 of the period. And you know your unit circle by now, I hope. And you know as you go around the unit circle at 0, pi over 2, pi, 3 pi over 2, and back to 2 pi, that there's four places around that circle that you have those easy values of 1, 0, and negative 1. 0 degrees, where this point is 1, 0. At pi over 2, or 90 degrees, we're going to do radians, where our point is 0, 1, and then where our point is negative 1, 0, and of course, 0, negative 1, and back to the beginning. So we're going to be looking for those four points as we rotate around the unit circle, those four points. We're going to count by a quarter of the period. That's why we're doing this one quarter idea, to hit those four easy points around the unit circle. Okay, let's do an example. Let's take a look at the parent function very, very quickly of y equals the sine of x. Now, this has an amplitude of 1. Now, of course, I'll erase all my notes because I'd have somewhere to write, but the leading coefficient is the amplitude. So the absolute value of a is the amplitude. This is going to have an amplitude that is equal to 1. The period is going to be 2 pi divided by b, which we find in front of the x, so it'll be 1, so it's 2 pi. We have a phase shift. Well, there's no plus or minus inside of a set of parentheses. It's just the sine of x, so there is no phase shift. And the vertical shift is when we have a plus or minus at the end of the equation. There is none. This is the parent function. And we're going to count by one quarter of the period. So we're going to count by 1/4 of the period of 2 pi, which is 2 times 1 is 2 pi over 4, which reduces down to pi over 2. Now, where did I just say the easy points were? Since our period is a standard 2 pi, it's going to, you know, 0, pi over 2, pi, 3 pi over 2, and 2 pi. Counting by this value is going to give me my easy values of 0, 1, and 2. Now, let's take a look at the graph. It's going to look like this. Actually, no, excuse me, we need a t-table. Okay, so we're going to set up our t-table with x and y equals the sine of x. And unlike my previous video, where basic understanding of sine and cosine, we're not going to plot, you know, 12 points, just 4, or 5, excuse me. So start the phase shift, and then count by 1 quarter of the period. So 0, pi over 2, 2 pi over 2, 3 pi over 2, and 4 pi over 2. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 x values. That'll be enough to get your first period of the graph set up. Period, by the way, is the horizontal distance it takes for the graph to repeat. So once you get your first period, you can just set that stamp, and the whole process will just keep cycling over and over again as you rotate around that unit circle. Of course, we get repetitive values, and that sets up the idea of period when you graph a function, or trig function. So the sine of 0 is 0, the sine of pi over 2 is 1, the sine of 2 pi over 2, or the sine of pi, when you rotate pi radians, the sine or y value there, because sine is y over r, is back to 0. When you rotate 3 pi over 2, your y value or your sine value is negative 1. And then, of course, 4 pi over 2, that's 2 pi. So all the way around the unit circle, back to the beginning, the sine there is equal to 0. So I need some room to write, so I hope you copy those directions down. I don't need to see them. I know what they are. And let's graph y equals the sine of x. Now, I just made a mistake. When you graph these without the aid of a graphing calculator, you should first simply draw your x-axis, and don't forget x is domain. And we do plug angle measures into trig functions, so our x value is not representing the x values on a unit circle. That's not a graph of sine and cosine, that's a graph of a circle. When we set up a graph, the x-axis domain is theta. It's what we plug in the trig functions, an angle measure. Use these values along the t-table to set up your number line, or your x-axis. And if you don't happen upon 0, count backwards or forwards until you hit the value of 0. If you happen to skip over, like maybe you have an x value of pi over 4 and the next one is negative 3 pi over 4, well, that's fine. Just keep your spacing even And then if you just happen to skip over the zero, that's fine. Just keep your even spacing and then slide your y-axis down where the x value is zero. And that way, if you got, you don't want to space this big to represent pi over 8 and then have the exact same interval represent maybe pi over 2, right? That would be wrong. So set up that x-axis, count forward or backwards until you get to zero, and if you skip over it, cool, don't worry about it. Do not include zero if you do not count through zero on your t-table. And then just slide that y-axis down through zero where it belongs or in between your positive and negative x values. So, what do we have? 0, 0, pi over 2, 1, at pi sine 0, at 3 pi over 2 we're at negative 1, and at 2 pi we're back to 0. So we've graphed one period of the sine function. If I want two periods, now that I've got my count on with my x-axis, I can just continue that count and either extend it on this way or on backwards because my period, my one period is set up. Now I know the pattern. So I'm going to just keep counting backwards by my one quarter of the period, or just look at my x-axis. 2 pi, 3 pi over 2, 2 pi, 1 pi over 2, 0, negative pi over 2, negative 2 pi over 2, negative 3 pi over 2, and then finally, negative 2 pi. And look at my pattern. 0, negative 1, 0, 1, 0. So what's going to be the next one? Negative 1, back to 0, back to up to 1, and back up to 0. Let me just highlight the second period in a different color. And you see how that's sort of like a stamp that just repeated? That's a period. So a period is the horizontal distance it takes for a graph to repeat, a trig function graph to repeat. And look at the overall altitude. We go up to 1 and down to negative 1. So I would say the overall height is actually 2 units. 1 minus negative 1 is 2. And the amplitude, as I had written up here a second ago, the amplitude is half of the overall height. So, you know, if you take 1 minus negative 1 is 2 and half of 2 is equal to 1, and there's your amplitude, which is equal to 1. Now, let's do another example because you might think, well, why did you spend 5 minutes graphing the parent function? Well, let's now graph let's take a simple example like y equals sine of 2x and show you what this value of b does when it's greater than 1. Well, this is going to have an amplitude equal to 1, a period that's equal to 2 pi over 2, so that's going to be pi, a phase shift that is equal to 0 because there's no plus or minus inside the addition sign, a vertical shift that is equal to 0, and a count that's equal to pi over 4. So I can tell by the sound of the alarm going off in my pocket, I've only got 1 minute left, and I don't have the time to set up the t-table. I'm going to do a couple more examples in another video, but notice what this period is. It's pi. So that b value that's greater than 1 is going to cause this cycle to not take a distance of 2 pi, but this up and down cycle to take a horizontal distance of 1 pi. So when you have a b value that is bigger than 1, it's going to compress the graph. It's not going to stretch like a vertical transformation, but actually when your b value is bigger than 1, it's going to take that graph and squeeze it together. I'm going to have two more examples in my next video. No blabbering about how this stuff works or why. So check it out if you need it. Mr. True, go do your homework.